Hey, East Coast friends and family, I just want to welcome you to the service. Can we welcome everybody now from the Parkway to the Chapel to Coco to Vieira? Let's put our hands together and welcome in all of East Coast and our online family as well. We're so glad that you're here. We are continuing on with our Upgrade the Perspective season. This has been a season of where we've been asking God to upgrade our perspective. I want to introduce our speaker today. He's an associate pastor at the Vieira campus, as well as has been heading up the building project. And the building project is massive. It's one of the biggest things we've ever done. And we're just so thankful for this guy's heart, his effort, and the relationship he's had with this church for over 20 years. Can you put your hands together for Pastor Christian Hurston? Come on, welcome him now.
Hey, good morning, East Coast. Great to be here. Can we just put our hands together one more time for the one who's worthy of all of our praise, Jesus? Come on, make a bigger noise for him. As Pastor Matt said, my name is Christian, and I'm honored to be on the pastoral team here. But before I get started, I really just want to give some honor to Pastor Matt and Jessica, our staff, and our dream team, you, just for pouring your hearts out. This last few years have been crazy and incredible, and I'm just so proud of our leadership and our church for everything that we've been able to do to make an impact locally here and around the world. Put your hands together one more time. I also just need to honor my wife real quick because it's the right thing to do, and I love to do it. We've been married for nearly 19 years. August will be 19 years. We have a photo of them here. This is my beautiful wife, Anne Marie, my oldest son, Christian, my middle son, Rhythm, and Selah. And we've been around. We were originally at the Parkway about 13 years ago, and then Pastor Matt and Jessica called us down to Vieira. So I may not get to see all of you guys on a regular basis, but we're all East Coast, one church, many locations. Happy to be here. I want to start off with reading a letter from Pastor Matt and Jessica as they are on a family vacation right now, but I want to share this really to be able to convey their heart. So bear with me as I read. It's been a big week in our country. This week, for the second time as a nation, we observed Juneteenth as a federal holiday celebrating the final emancipation of enslavement for people in the United States. We also rejoiced as our Supreme Court overturned the decade-old ruling of Roe v. Wade, deciding that abortion is, in fact, not a constitutional right. As a church, we believe in the life and freedom Christ died for us to have, for every person of every color and every nation from conception to the grave. We recognize that these issues are complex and impact your stories in unique ways. So we celebrate these remarkable events while also recognizing that they are personal, that there are personal wounds that you might carry, and we stand with you in healing, redemption, and love. As a church, we will continue to stand against racism and support initiatives that promote life and abolish world slavery. We support the Agape Pregnancy Center, Pregnancy Resource Center, as well as LendCare, and support to our local foster care system and families involved. No matter where you or those that you know stand on these issues, let us unite together in Jesus Christ and the freedom we have in Him. Church, could we be different than the world and not allow bitterness, strife, and anger to lead us? Let us be a church to look for opportunities to love people even more and bring the message of Jesus to those who need hope in this season. Sincerely, Pastor Matt and Jessica in the East Coast family, put your hands together for that. I just want to pray real quick. Father, we thank you for this celebration of just marking an end of slavery, but we know that everyone is not free, that there's still human trafficking and people who are affected by slavery. And we thank you for this monumental event that we're not done. It's just the start, and we'll continue to be able to fight to the finish for all that you have for us to do. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, I want to give you a quick update on the building as I am the project manager, and this is an exciting report that I've been waiting for about a week and a half to share. So I'm excited to tell you that this last week, we were able to save $45,000 on the building. And how this happened is that we've known since before we broke ground that there was a chance that we would have to pay this cost, is that when you're building, you have to ensure that the emergency services, fire department, police can use the radios in the building. And you don't know if it's going to work until the construction is almost finished. And they asked us in the beginning, like, hey, do you want to put in this system proactively and just put it in case we're like, no, let's maybe just wait and see if we need it. That's 50 grand. So just this week, we did the test and we were able to confirm that we did not have to spend that money. Come on, church. Let's celebrate that. God is so good. That's money that we're going to be able to put towards other things and save and pay this building off to be debt-free. So speaking of the Vieira building, let's check out this video with some updates on Rise and Build.
Before I knew Jesus, I was very broken. I lived a very different lifestyle than I do now. I was definitely dependent on things that I shouldn't have been, and I wasn't hanging out with the right people. I was smoking and drinking every night. I didn't know what it was like to fall asleep without being under the influence. Living in my apartment when I was in college, my ex was selling drugs out of the apartment that we were living in. And so there were people who I didn't know going in and out of the apartment all the time. I never knew what to expect. So could it be the police knocking on the door and I would have to answer it with all the things that I knew were in the house? Or was it gonna be somebody who was gonna be armed to take all of it? There was a pivotal night that I was out with a few friends from work, including my now husband, Cole, and I got home and my ex was on the floor passed out drunk at 8 or 9 o'clock at night. And I realized that I didn't want this to be the rest of my life. And what it felt like was that my life was on a loop of getting wasted, getting up for work, and starting all the way over again. So I realized that after 7 years, I was done. I just wanted more. I wanted better for my life. Had not too much at that point. I had like a bed and some clothes, and I decided I needed to start over somewhere that wasn't here. So I was new to Merritt Island, and Cole invited me to East Coast, and I was very overwhelmed, but everybody was really nice and really welcoming. To see that environment of people loving Jesus and loving each other was very new to me. We kept coming back week after week and Sunday after Sunday. And I realized that after all that I've been through, that God was the piece that was missing. And that's when I decided to give my life to Christ. And after that, I got baptized and God put it on my heart to go to a freedom group. I'm so thankful that I went through freedom, that it changed my life. I was carrying so much around. Freedom gave me an outlet. I could go to God with those things. It was transformational. Soon after freedom, Cole and I got married, and we had an incredible baby boy named Malachi, who's now 15 months old. The East Coast community has been so gracious to us, and we have friends who are single, we have friends who have families, we have friends who are much older that we met during our time with freedom. East Coast has really made a place for me to feel safe and loved and valued. It's nice that we have a place to call home and we have an East Coast family that I wouldn't trade for anything.
Hey guys, we are in the final push of Rise and Build. Let's read this scripture together. Then I told them how the hand of my God has been favorable to me, and also about the words that the king had spoken to me. And they said, let us rise up and build. So they thoroughly supported the good work. That's Nehemiah 2:18. Let's check out this video update. We are giving towards the Vieira building. This is fight to the finish line. We have crossed $1.2 million and we are going all the way. We're going to be filling up the building with furniture and coffee machines and lights and sound and all of those things. But you know the most important thing that we're going to put in that building? It's a chair. And we're asking you to give towards those chairs. There are 600 chairs and each chair represents $500. We're asking that you prayerfully consider what you would give in this season. Maybe you'd buy a chair for a teenager or a kid. Maybe you'd buy a chair for a family, or maybe you'd buy a whole row. Each chair represents a person.
I know for me, I grew up in church all my life, but so much of my experience spiritually up to that point was not a personal walk with God, more a secondhand experience of my parents' faith. But when I walked through the doors of this church as a broken 17-year-old girl with divorced parents and uncertainty about my future, and I was able to sit in a chair in this church, I met people who loved me where I was at and welcomed me in with open arms. I'm grateful I grew up in church because I met Jesus as a child, but I encountered the Holy Spirit here at East Coast.
I am so glad that there was a chair for you when you came to this church. And you know, that wasn't just a chair in an auditorium here on a Sunday morning service, but you came to the mezzanine. There was a chair for you there. You know, there were chairs for you. There's chairs for me. There's chairs for my kids in kids church right now. Each season of life, we see these chairs that they represent a person's place where they can come in and grow with Christ, that they can see a marriage restored, that they could grow up in kids church and be taught the word of God. The sound could get shut off. The power could get shut off. We could have, you know, I don't know, the coffee machine would stop working. That doesn't matter if we have a chair for somebody to sit in and be a part of what God is doing here at East Coast Christian Center. Here's what I'm asking you to do. Give and pray. Pray for the work to be done quickly and that we would hit this finish line. Pray for the supplies to be delivered. Pray for people to see the vision and join the dream team, and pray that God is glorified, and pray that every chair will be filled up. We're not going to be moving bricks until August 7th. We're going to take up two special offerings right here in July. That's going to be July 24th and July 31st. So be praying what you would give in those two offerings. We're going to fight to the finish line. I'm not telling you to give or even what to give. I'm asking you to ask God and then release what's in your heart. Thank you.
With less than $300,000 left to reach our goal of $1.5 million, we're excited to do a final push to fight to the finish, as Pastor Matt said. Today, we want to tell you about our Sponsor a Chair campaign to get us across the finish line and into the new Vieira building, this building right here. Last year, Pastor Matt asked this question, what is the impact of a chair? Each chair represents a person, a story, an opportunity for someone to encounter the God of the universe. In each of our chairs, in each of these locations, big things happen. The lost are found, families are restored, children feel loved, valued, and accepted. Addictions are broke free, strangers become friends and family.
As I stand here in the first through fourth grade classroom, we're making room for God's treasure, people. Each chair represents us making room for other families, for parents, for students, and grandparents. And each chair symbolizes a space for the people of our community, no matter what walk of life, to find a place called home. We want to love people, and we do it through chairs like this.
The new Vieira building will be set up with 600 chairs. Would you pray about sponsoring a chair for someone else to make room, to provide a place for families to come and to sit, to feel welcome, accepted, and loved? Maybe this would be a chair for your one, or maybe it'd be a row of chairs for your neighbors or coworkers. Chairs can be sponsored for $500 each. Would you pray and ask God about He's leading you to participate?
So while I stand here in the sanctuary of our new property, I want to say that the bricks are not going to go away. We're excited to move that last brick and to celebrate reaching and exceeding the $1.5 million goal before our first service in this new building. Anything that comes in during this Sponsor a Chair campaign will go towards that overall rise and build goal. Each one of our 600 chairs, if they're all sponsored, we're gonna blow that $1.5 million goal away. I can't wait to see what the Lord's gonna do. As we set our sights on crossing the finish line and making room for the people of our community to find a church home, come on church, let's do this. Let's go.
Yeah, it's awesome, isn't it? I'm so excited to see what we can accomplish as a church through this Rise and Build. And we've said this from the beginning, when one of us rise, we all rise. There were one church in many locations, and we're going to be able to do it together. So I want to get right into my message here. We are in the middle of our upgrade season. It's so much more than just a series that we're doing. As last week, Pastor Brian brought an incredible message about labels and maybe re-identifying those labels that we put on ourselves or others do. The week before, Pastor Jessica had an amazing word on faith, and we've heard so many good teachings that will stick with us. Today, I get the privilege to talk to you about upgrading your perspective on failure. Everybody say failure. It's like, oh man, that sounds fun, doesn't it? It's like, oh, just saying it feels kind of weird. Anyone here ever failed before? Like, come on, be honest. We're in church. Thank you for being real with me. Is that if you just took a moment and closed your eyes and thought back to some of your biggest failures, like, it's not fun to rehearse them. But we're going to be looking in the Bible today to some people that maybe had some failures and how they responded to it. And I'm not going to call anyone to stand up and share yours, but guess what? Since I got the mic, I'll be vulnerable and share a little bit of my story. So I grew up in a Christian household. I was a missionary kid, grew up in Haiti. And even though I was around church and kind of knew the right things to do, my family went through a divorce when I was young, and I ran far from God. Is that I got in trouble in school, got kicked out, ended up in trouble with the police, was going down this course of my life where it could have dictated the whole rest of my life. But praise God, at 19, I got saved. I turned my heart over to the Lord. And these are some of the essential things. Giving my heart to Jesus, marrying a godly woman, starting to just say, God, I don't want to live that way. I want to change my perspective. And I was able to go to college, work on my career. This is crazy, but I was able to get a secret clearance, even with kind of a bumpy past, and to be able to put my life back on track, all because of Jesus. So we're going to look at some of these people in the Bible that maybe chose the right way or chose the different way. The character we're going to focus on first is this guy, Demas. Everybody say Demas. So I get the privilege of teaching at our university, East Coast Christian University. And so I want to take you guys to Bible college today. Are you okay going to Bible college for a little bit? Is the biggest thing that I want to teach you in this next few minutes is how to mine out truth from just a simple verse. This is exactly what Pastor Matt and Jessica have been saying for us for this whole series and this season, is to get into your paper Bible, get out your notebook, start digging in there, mining the truth out for yourself, circling those words, studying them. And this is exactly how I got this message, is I wasn't studying to prepare a sermon. I was just doing my own personal Bible study. I saw this name Demas, and I'm like, you know what? I don't know anything about him. I want to dig in and be able to learn some more. So this is what I discovered. Demas is not a popular name among Christians. I've never met a person named Demas, and you probably haven't either. It's not a normal Bible name like Matthew, David, John. It's not someone, it's like naming your kid Judas. It's like kind of weird. His full name was Demetrius. And many of the early Christians would change their names when they got saved to represent following the Christ. That's what I did, is that when I was kind of a heathen, crazy teenager, I was Chris. But when I got saved, I changed my name to Christian. It was like, that old guy is dead. Now I go by Christian. He chose to keep his name Demetrius or Demas, this pagan or worldly name. And I think it's interesting that Demas kind of sounds like demon. Anybody else think about that? It's like, it just feels kind of wrong. So his name may be overlooked and even rejected by some, but his example has been followed and repeated for the last 2,000 years. That we first see mention of Demas in Paul's letter to Philemon. And in that verse, he mentioned him as a fellow worker. Let's look at this first scripture, Philemon 1:2-4. It says, "And so do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my fellow workers." So to be mentioned next to this guy, Mark and Luke, is a big deal. Most people think that Paul the Apostle wrote the most text in the New Testament because he wrote 13 letters, epistles in there. But it's actually this guy, Luke, who wrote two super books, the book of Luke and the book of Acts, who wrote more words than any other person. So here's this heavy hitter, Luke. Then there's this other guy, Mark, who historians say wrote one of the Gospels. And then even this guy Aristarchus was an important figure in the book of Acts and Paul's missionary journeys. Is that we read that he accompanied Paul to Rome, and church history tells us that he remained faithful to the end of his life. Although scripture mentions Aristarchus only a few times, His background and later life were unknown. We know that Aristarchus was a faithful follower of Christ and served alongside Paul. A few biblical references to Aristarchus remind Christians that a believer does not need to be high profile in order to accomplish great things. Come on, that's a good word. He may not be very visible to others in serving Christ, but we are still seen and valued by the Lord. It's not all about the spotlight. I'm reminded of that Lecrae song, Background. Pastor Chris would sing a line for me if I let him. But, you know, we can play the background and not have to always be in front. But let's get back to Demas. The first time we hear Paul talk about him, he is a fellow worker. Everybody say fellow worker. He holds him in this high esteem and honor, literally with writers of the Bible. But now let's look at the next mention of him in Colossians 4:14. It reads, "Our dear friend Luke, the doctor, and Demas send greetings." So it appears that Demas has been maybe downgraded a little bit. He's gone from being a fellow worker to just plain Demas. We know that Paul doesn't mind honoring or using colorful language because in the same sentence, he's like, "Hey, our dear friend, the doctor, Luke, and this guy, Demas." So I want to ask, what happened between Philemon and Colossians? What's going on with Demas? And I told you we're going to go to Bible college, so stick with me on some of these dates. The epistle of Philemon is thought to be written first chronologically. It's composed between 57 and 62 AD. So we see that Paul's love for Demas is in that letter. Colossians is written only a few years later, thought to be written between 60 and 62. It looks like Demas started really strong, but was beginning to fade away. Now let's be real for a second. We know that Paul was an intense guy. He ran off people, and he was not the easiest to work with. If you read his letters and you read through the book of Acts, you'll see that he was frustrated at times with Luke, Barnabas, Mark, Peter, and others. Like, he certainly would have been frustrated with me too. But I love that about the Bible, is that it doesn't hold anything back. It shows the real people. It shows our failures and flaws, and that I can be intense sometimes too, but God can still use me in spite of myself. But let's not discount the lesson that we can learn from Demas. His experience, his faithfulness, or the lack of faithfulness just because Paul was a difficult leader. Let's look at the final verse regarding Demas, and this one starts to get a little bit painful. 2 Timothy 4:10 reads, "For Demas, having loved the pleasures of this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica." It can be inferred here that Demas loved the things of the world more than he loved the things of God. In fact, Demas did more than just leave Paul. The Bible says that he deserted him. And you're probably saying, being deserted, that doesn't sound so bad. One of my first thoughts was that movie, The Grinch with Jim Carrey. Come on, who likes that movie? It's so good. As I love that when The Grinch is being celebrated as the holiday cheermeister, and he's on the chair, they're shoving the pies into his face and the fudge, and they're celebrating. It's like, hey, being deserted, that's not so bad, but we're not talking about that here. We're talking about being deserted and left. The Bible translation of that word means to be left and lurch. Or today we might use a phrase, left me in the ditch to die. It's like, ouch. Everybody say ouch. That's hard. So look at the progression that took place with Demas. He went from friend of Paul, fellow worker, to deserter and leaving the ministry. Now I want to get serious. How many of you known someone who was fired up? Maybe they just got saved or they had this incredible encounter with God and they're like, I'm gonna join this small group, lead this small group, join the dream team. I'm gonna go in full-time ministry, be a worship leader, go be a missionary. And they're like on fire for God. Come on, put your hand up. Have you known that person? Me too. How many of you have been that person before? I'm putting both my hands up. I see them. Thank you for being real. Is that you're like, I'm all in, God. I'm going to read my Bible every day, and I'm never going to stop it. I'm going to follow you no matter what. And then guess what? We get distracted by that shiny object. Like, squirrel, like, it's so easy. is that many of us had that experience, honestly, with COVID, is that when regular church got shut down and we were like not in church on Sundays, who out there was on the boat on Sunday or maybe at the beach, and you get into that new routine to where it's like it's easy to get out of this regular routine of putting God first. So I'm right there with you. It's so easy to get distracted. But let's look again at 2 Timothy 4:10. Paul wrote this, "For Demas, having loved the pleasure of this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica." We see in Paul's final letter at the end of his life, when he's in prison in Rome, that Demas abandoned him to return to his old life in Thessalonica. This was probably one of Paul's lowest moments, when he needed his fellow workers the most. Some of us that are guilty of desertion start off best, but remember, it's not about how you start, but about how you finish. Come on. Now, this is going to get a little bit heavier, so stick with me. 2 Timothy is the last time that the Bible talks about Demas, but church history teaches us that Demas became an apostate and turned his back on religion. Most people believe that there was about 6 to 8 years between the time frame of going strong in the ministry to forsaking Paul. So how did Demas apostatize from the church? I got to ask you, what does that word even mean? I'll be honest, I teach at our university, and before studying this message, I did not know what apostatize means. Come on, put your hand up if you know what it means. We got a few Bible scholars in here. Good job. I have it on the screen. So apostatize means to renounce a religious or political belief or principle. Good job being more spiritual, because I did not know what that meant. So Paul gives this reason that he said Demas was in love with this present world. Demas is the perfect example of how many today fall into apostasy and never return to what they had once tasted and seen. Demas, letting his guard down, allowed the world to fulfill his desires. When Paul writes that Demas loved the things of this world more than the things of God, he did not use the word for the physical world we think of, like cosmos, like the planet. Instead, he used the word eon for this present age. It was the entrapment of the world and the things of it. Thessalonica, where Demas left Paul to return to, was a major city with trade, commerce, food. Come on, Pastor Chris. They had the best food. They had all the best TripAdvisor. Like, we knew it was a place that you'd want to be. But in looking at Paul and Demas's view of the world, Paul cared about the future age and the lost and dying world, and not just the current age and what the world had to offer. And I will be completely vulnerable with you. This really challenges me. My wife and I, we just bought a brand new house about a year ago, and we have been like in mega consumer mode, more than we ever have, to where we wanted to get our little generic Roomba. I can't get the real one, but the fake Roomba vacuum. We got the smart house where I control everything with my app. We're buying furniture and doing this stuff, and I'm convicted to think about, hey, do I have the stuff or does the stuff have me? Anybody ever dealt with that? Where it's like, we like this stuff, but you can't let the stuff take over to where it controls you. So in the end, what happened to Demas? We don't know for sure. All we know that is in some of the last words the Apostle Paul wrote before his Roman execution, it expresses this heartbreak. Demas, in love with this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica. Maybe Demas feared being executed with Paul and fled to safety. Hey, guess what? I can feel that. Like, I'm not lining up first to get my head cut off to be able to be a martyr for Christ. Can you guys understand? Like, that's a hard thing to do, but we don't know for sure. Maybe he succumbed to immorality, or maybe he simply caved in to the relentless temptation of a more comfortable, prosperous life in a large, wealthy, culturally interesting city of Thessalonica. Whatever it was, Paul saw it as embracing the world. But just a few sentences later, in this same exact letter to Timothy, Paul says something that is so hope-giving. 2 Timothy 4:11 says, "Get Mark and bring him with you, for he is very useful to me for the ministry." Remember this guy, Mark? We talked about him in the first verse. It was Luke, Mark, Aristarchus. Well, we don't always realize that Mark was the first one to desert Paul. Back in the early days of the church, during the first missionary journey with Paul and Barnabas, Mark took off and he returned back to Jerusalem. Again, we don't know exactly why, but Paul did not approve. He was angry about this. In fact, when Barnabas wanted to bring Mark back on the team after the Jerusalem Council, Paul was like, nope, get him out of here. He's dead to me. I don't want him around. But here is Mark at the end of Paul's life, fully reconciled with Paul and trusted to be used in the ministry. Demas and Mark serve as this contrast. One provides a word of warning, the other a word of hope. And as people who stumble in many ways, we need both, guys. This is so important to take this in. Mark gives us hope. He had a weak start. He didn't appear to have the right stuff. He disappointed his leaders and friends by leaving them in the heat of battle. And one of our core values here at East Coast, you'll see it in all of our lobbies, is one step, is that we're called to keep growing on our journey with the Lord one step at a time. So we all have one step. Even if we blow it, we can get back in the game and get back on track. Put your hands together for that. Come on. Mark ended well, and at some point, he rejoined the battle and proved a faithful, trusted, useful warrior. And if Bible tradition is correct, God used him to write one of the four Gospels in the New Testament. That is incredible. It would have been easy for Mark to throw in the towel, give up, but he didn't. Here's a practical example for our lives of ways that we can be able to keep running after God just one step at a time. Play that first clip for me with the locomotive. So I love this clip. It's fun to go on YouTube and start looking things. The name of this clip says fire-breathing dragon train in China, because it's like you see that fire coming out of that exhaust. I don't think that they could probably even get away with that in America because it looked like it was going to blow up. But though, in order to do that, guess what they're doing? They're feeding the fire. We're on the East Coast here, so we all heard this before. It's like, bro, I'm stoked. You ever hear that term? Like, I'm so stoked. Hey, get fired up. Is these terms come from this idea of stoking the flames, is you have to keep feeding the fire for it to keep going. The same idea of stoking it. Play that other clip for me. As you see them, is they're taking this coal and they're feeding into the fire. It's a continual process of feeding the fire, keeping it stoked and keeping it hot. But when you stop stoking the flames, the train starts to slow slightly. It's almost imperceptible that the train can keep rolling for a long time before it eventually stops. But once it stops, it's so much harder to get it going again. So I have to ask you, what about your life? How long can you coast without feeding those flames? Is it days? Is it weeks or even years? Then all of a sudden, you come to a screeching halt and you wonder what happened. The fire stopped getting fed way back when, but you're finally dealing with it now. It might have been that you got fired up in that freedom group a couple years ago where you're doing Bible study every week together for 12 weeks and you come to the retreat and your life gets changed. Or maybe you think back to that encounter at youth camp when you were there and you were like worshiping God and you got the snot bubbles coming out and you're just like, God, I'll follow you no matter what. But you haven't been getting back into the Word. And I'm not trying to beat anybody up here. This is an encouragement for every one of us just to keep feeding that fire. And this is what Paul says to do in the same book, 2 Timothy 1:6. It says this, "For this reason, I remind you to fan into the flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands." I got Luke coming up here. He's going to help me with an example. Is that what are practical ways that you could be able to fan the flames? And I'm going to tell you, it's as simple as this. This is our core values, is getting into the Word of God, putting God first, showing up in worship as you guys already do. And you know what? You're in church. I'm kind of preaching to the choir here. Maybe there's someone in your life that you could think of that they're like, you know, they're feeling far from God. Send them that Bible verse today. Call them and pray over them. Send them that worship song and help them out. And Luke's got this blazing hot fire here. Watch out. Don't get burned, bro. And this idea of just feeding the flame, putting it in here. This is getting in the Word. This is getting into worship. This is showing up in small group. And here we've got this hot coal that out, hot, is that you take this. Once it's out of the fire, I got to ask, how long can that coal stay hot for? It was burning hot to where it's smoldering. But when you separate it from small group, from church, from doing life with other Christians, and it's standing alone by itself, how long is it going to stay hot? Minutes? Maybe 10, 15? But you got to get that thing back into the fire and keep it blazing hot. Great job, Lou. Give him a hand. You guys are already doing it, but let's get those people back, those ones who maybe haven't come back from COVID and they're still at home, and say, come back, get back into life with us. Let's do life together. Reach out to that person today. I've got a personal testimony of this, that this is a tough one to be able to share, but I've already been so vulnerable, I'm just going to lay it out with you, is that I've been in ministry for a number of years now, and even going all the way back to 2007, I got a chance to go into full-time ministry. I had left a family business. It was a big deal, and I went into ministry, and I was like, God, this is it. I'm going. But we had a 2007-2008 housing crisis. You guys remember that? When literally the whole economy just got shaken and rocked. Well, I wasn't able to stay in ministry. I had to go back into the marketplace to provide for my family. And it was tough. I wrestled with God about that. I had a desire to be back in the ministry, but it just didn't line up. And then an opportunity came for me to be able to come onto staff at East Coast. We showed up around 2009 in that time frame. And later on, an opportunity came up. But the challenge was is that didn't line up with what I had thought. You ever have your own plans and God's plans are different? So when it first came up, it was an opportunity to maybe come on 5 to 7 hours as like a stipend while I worked my regular job. Just Pastor Matt and Jessica like, hey, we need your help. Come and do this thing. And I was like, let's go. Let's do it. And then it later materialized into coming on 20 hours into part-time. And it was at that time when I'm working like 3 jobs, providing for the family, I had this very low moment. And I will tell you, it was a straight attack from the enemy. As I remember the first week that I was in the building here on staff, and this is not against East Coast or against God, this was a personal attack against me from the enemy. I was sitting in an office and I was feeling so discouraged. And I'm like, God, this is not what I saw and planned. It was supposed to be different. And I was feeling beat up, and I'm so grateful that I called my dad, who's been in the ministry now for over 45 years as a missionary, as a minister and a pastor. And I called him like, Dad, I don't know what to do. I just feel like quitting. It's so tempting to just go back to the comfort and the security of this other thing. And he's like, son, stay the course. The Bible says when you've done all to stand and to keep fighting and not give up. And so he prayed with me, and I'm so excited to tell you, literally the next day, things were different. God had just renewed my mind. He took that anxiety and that pressure off of me, and the rest is history. It's been nearly 7 years now of me being on full-time ministry, and God provided. And I'm so excited to say this, that even though we kind of had to step out of the boat onto the water financially, God supernaturally provided during that year to where we had more money in our bank account than we had ever had in our entire marriage supernaturally. Come on, give God a hand for that. I'm so glad I didn't quit and I continued to press through. And I want to share this quote from you. It's actually one that Pastor Dan shared with me years ago and marked my life. It says, in life, we will have a moment of courage or a lifetime of regret. I want to share it again. In life, we will have a moment of courage or a lifetime of regret. Is that what would it have been like if Demas would have stayed the course and not given up? If he would have continued to run after God and done the more difficult thing, would there literally be a book of the Bible named after him? I mean, he's running with Luke and Mark in this company, but no, he faded away. So I want to remind you of this. It's not about just how you start, but it's how you finish. The key is not to do it alone. Is that Jesus is with you through it all. Is that we never have to do it by ourselves. The Bible promises that he will never leave us and he will never forsake us. And the Bible tells us again that God will work all things together for the good to those who love him and those who are the called according to his purpose. So you might have had failure. I saw those hands up there. Don't let those things define you. Today is the day of salvation. Today is a day that you could say, God, no matter what happened before in the past, I'm going to run hard after you. And if you're out there and you've never had this relationship with Christ, I want to give you an opportunity to be able to do that right now. We read in Romans 10, 9, and 10, that if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ died and rose again, then you will be saved. So we're going to say a prayer as a church. I want everyone to say it with me right now. Close your eyes and say this. Father God, thank you for sending Jesus to die on the cross for me, to take my place. I believe Jesus is Lord, and I believe you raised him from the dead. Jesus, be my Lord and be my Savior. Thank you for forgiving me and setting me free. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you said that prayer and made the decision to follow Christ, we want to honor you right now. We're not going to call you out or embarrass you in any way, but I just want you to be bold. And on the count of three, throw your hand up so we can celebrate you right now. One, two, three. Throw that hand up and say, that's me. I made the decision to follow Christ. Come on, church. That is so awesome. The Bible says that when even just one make the decision to follow him, that all of heaven celebrates. So we just want to say right now, welcome home. Welcome to the family. Thank you for the opportunity to share with you. God bless. I'm going to turn it back over to Pastor Brian at this time.